Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining today's masterclass on abdominal tuberculosis by Dr. Sudhir Jain. I, Sumita Roy, with my colleague Priyanka Jain from the marketing team of Elsevier India, will be moderating the session today. Before we start, I would like to tell all the attendees that you will not be able to unmute yourself during the session. Should you have any questions related to the topic in discussion, you can post them in the Q&A tab on your screen. These questions will be addressed by Dr. Jain at the end of his session. And now, it is my honor to introduce you to our esteemed speaker. Professor Sudhir Jain is the Director, Professor and Head in the Department of Surgery at Maulana Azad Medical College and Associated Hospital, New Delhi. With over 100 publications and presentations, Dr. Jain takes keen interest in surgical education at both undergraduate and postgraduate levels. Dr. Jain has an international experience in surgery with his prior engagement with the North Middlesex Hospital, United Kingdom. Dr. Sudhir Jain is a highly commended author and has been awarded by the British Medical Association in the field of surgery. Dr. Jain is also an alumnus at the Faculty of Management Studies with 4 books in surgery to his credit. And with that, I request Dr. Jain to please take this session forward. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon to everybody. Thank you, Sumita. Thank you, Kritika and Priyanka, for inviting me. I welcome all the students and delegates who have joined us. Today I will be speaking on abdominal tuberculosis. You must be wondering that in this era of COVID, when most of the webinars are on COVID and management and recent advances, why I have chosen to speak on tuberculosis. I have chosen to speak on abdominal tuberculosis. Firstly, that we should not forget tuberculosis in India. It's still a pertinent problem, burning problem. We have been trying very hard to bring the tuberculosis under control, but still it is, the incidence of tuberculosis is increasing. And then it is a very important topic from your exam point of view. So as I go on, I will tell you how much is the global incidence of tuberculosis, and it is still a relevant and important problem which humanity needs to control. Now, few words about the tuberculosis. The Charles Dickens described tuberculosis as a dreaded disease in which there is a gradual and quiet struggle between soul and body, leading to, in which the mortal part of the body withers away grain by grain, that means slowly, and get wasted. So way back in 1860, the Charles Dickens described the tuberculosis like this. However, that time the bacteria for the tuberculosis was not discovered, but from his experience he described that the bacteria for the tuberculosis was, as all of you know, was discovered in 1882, and that is known as acid fast bacillus, Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Now let us discuss about the global incidence of tuberculosis. The tuberculosis still is the among top 10 causes of death globally. In 2017, 10 million people across the world developed tuberculosis, and there were 1.3 million deaths. It has been estimated that 1/4 of the global population has latent tuberculosis infection. And the emergence of multi-drug resistance bacteria has made this problem more complicated. So there is an emergence of multi-drug resistance bacteria. Tuberculosis is a very significant problem and a burning problem and a health issue in developing countries like India, incidence of tuberculosis is increasing because of the poverty, because of the overcrowding, and because of the malnutrition. These are the typical problems of developing countries. It has, according to the WHO report, India has 26% of the total burden of tuberculosis, world tuberculosis cases. So India has a significant tuberculosis problem. Today we are discussing about abdominal tuberculosis, which is an extra pulmonary tuberculosis. This extra pulmonary tuberculosis, it occurs in 20% of all TB cases. And out of those 20%, 10% of those extra pulmonary tuberculosis are abdominal tuberculosis. Now let me tell you from my experience that abdominal tuberculosis is a great mimicker. It can mimic any illness. It can mimic any inflammatory pathology. It can mimic any cancer. It can mimic any other disease. So there has to be a strong suspicion of tuberculosis, abdominal tuberculosis. If you are dealing with a chronic abdominal problem, patient presenting with a chronic abdominal pain, you have done all types of tests. You have done CT, you have done blood tests, and you are not able to pinpoint about the diagnosis. My teachers taught me that undiagnosed abdominal pain, think of abdominal tuberculosis if you are not able to pinpoint any diagnosis. So much so, at that time, when I was a student, I was taught that you can even start the therapeutic trial of anti-tubercular drugs, which many people may not agree today, but decade ago, in 1990, if there is an undiagnosed tuberculosis problem, malignancy ruled out, we used to give 6 weeks trial of anti-tubercular therapy. That was known as therapeutic trial. And many of the older generation of physicians still believe in these therapeutic trials. This abdominal tuberculosis can involve any single abdominal organ without chest TB. It can mimic any malignancy. It can mimic any infectious disease. And the correct clinical diagnosis is possible only in 50% of cases. So you can see that in the 50% of patients, you may not be able to diagnose abdominal tuberculosis clinically. You may be able to diagnose after the operation. You may be able to diagnose after the biopsy, but clinical diagnosis may not be possible in remaining 50% of abdominal tuberculosis. Such is the magnitude of the problem. So I will say, abdominal tuberculosis is a diagnostic challenge for the clinicians. It has non-specific presentation, and diagnostic delay leads to complications. Complications like perforation, peritonitis, intestinal obstruction, which I deal with later on. So for early diagnosis, high index of suspicion is required. Now people think if the patient doesn't have a pulmonary tuberculosis, he can't have abdominal tuberculosis. That is not true. Only 15 to 20% of the patients of abdominal tuberculosis have a concomitant chest tuberculosis. Now, why there is a re-emergence of the abdominal tuberculosis in the world? In the developed countries, re-emergence, like in UK, USA, it is because of the migrating population. It is because of the migrating population. Now, if I have to go to UK and USA for a long-term visit, every one of us has to get a tuberculosis test done. It is because of the aging population in the developed countries, and it is because of the increasing incidence of HIV infections. In the developing countries, there is a re-emergence of the tuberculosis. It is because of the incomplete treatment. It is because of the development of the multi-drug resistance strains, and it is also because of the increase in the HIV. So HIV With HIV, there's an increased incidence of tuberculosis, any type of tuberculosis. I'm not talking about abdominal tuberculosis alone. Incidence of tuberculosis has increased. Abdominal tuberculosis can involve any part of the gastrointestinal tract, and it is the sixth most frequent site of extrapulmonary involvement. 36% of the patients who are having HIV develop tuberculosis, out of which 50% have a abdominal tuberculosis. So the 36% of the HIV patient will develop tuberculosis. And out of those 36% with tuberculosis, 50% will have abdominal tuberculosis. The most common site of GI involvement in tuberculosis is the ileocecal region. We'll discuss why the ileocecal region is most commonly involved later on. Now, what are the source of infection for abdominal tuberculosis? It can be because of the ingestion of the mycobacterium. If the patient is suffering from pulmonary tuberculosis, patient can swallow his or her infected sputum. It is most commonly mycobacterium tuberculosis. It can be because of the use of the dairy product. If the milk is used unboiled, unpasteurized in the rural areas, in the villages, few of the people, there is a practice that they drink the milk directly without boiling or pasteurizing it. That will cause gastrointestinal tuberculosis. And most commonly, if it occurs because of the dairy products, it is Mycobacterium bovis. It can be hematogenous spread from the pulmonary tuberculosis. It can be a direct extension from contagious organs, like from the fallopian tubes. Now, what are the various forms of abdominal tuberculosis? The various forms of abdominal tuberculosis are peritoneal tuberculosis, luminal tuberculosis, or that is also known as gastrointestinal tuberculosis, visceral tuberculosis, lymph node involvement of the abdomen. Now, what are the various types of peritoneal tuberculosis? The most common type of peritoneal tuberculosis is the wet type, in which the patient presents with ascites. That is the most common type, chronic ascites. Other type is the dry plastic type of peritoneal tuberculosis, which leads to adhesions, very difficult to treat. It can be fixed fibrotic type, presenting with abdominal mass, or the worst type is abdominal cocoon, in which there is a thick fibrous layer which forms over the intestine. If you open the abdomen, you will not see the intestine. Instead, you will see the fibrous layer which covers whole or the part of the intestine. That is the abdominal cocoon. Now, as I said, the most common type of peritoneal tuberculosis is the tubercular ascites. If you tap a ascitic fluid in tuberculosis, what is the characteristic of this ascitic fluid? That fluid will be straw colored fluid. It will be clear straw colored exudate. If you estimate the protein in that fluid, it will be more than 3 g/cent. The cells will be more than 1000 per cubic millimeter, and they will be mainly lymphocytes. If they are mainly neutrophils, that it goes against the tuberculosis. Serum albumin ascitic gradient. If you measure the serum albumin of the ascitic fluid, if you measure the albumin level of the serum, if you take a ratio, it will be less than 1.1. The most diagnostic characteristic of ascitic fluid in the tuberculosis is estimation of ADA. ADA, if you measure the ascitic ADA, it will be more than 33 units per ml. However, there's a rider on that. ADA may be normal or low in patients with HIV with tuberculosis. But as such, the estimation of ascitic fluid adenosine deaminase is very much diagnostic of tubercular ascites. Now, other type which I want to discuss is the tubercular abdominal cocoon. It is also known as sclerosing and encapsulating peritonitis. most of the time is present as a chronic pain, lump, or the patient will come with the obstruction. There is a formation of membrane around hole or the spot of the small gut. The preoperative diagnosis is not possible majority of the time. However, it can be diagnosed by CT or MRI. But in my experience, most of the patients, they are diagnosed on operation table during the operation. It is a very usual story that most of the senior resident doctors, they ring me that, sir, there is a patient coming with intestinal obstruction. It looks to be tuberculosis. And we are going ahead. And whenever they open the abdomen, they again will ring me that say that, sir, can you come back to the theater and help me? Because they are not able to see any intestine. They only see the membrane. Then it needs a very meticulous dissection, removing the membrane. And if you remove that membrane which covers the intestine, you will see the gut. So it's a very challenging operation. And one has to be aware of that condition before you can diagnose. Otherwise, you can be caught unaware. Now, the most other type is luminal tuberculosis. Intestinal tuberculosis is the most common. And when it involves the intestine, the ileocecal region is the most common type. Isolated colonic tuberculosis is not that common, but still can occur. Esophageal is very rare. Gastroduodenal is very rare. Third most common is perianal tuberculosis, which is presenting with multiple fistula and ano. So intestinal tuberculosis, ileocecal region is the most common with the involvement of the terminal ileum. It occurs in 64% of cases. Now it's a very common question asked in the examination, whether in the practical or in the theory, that what are the reasons why the ileocecal region is most commonly involved in abdominal tuberculosis? No, the answer should be that because of the patency of the ileocecal valve, there is a stasis of the intestinal contents in the terminal ileum. The content of the intestine comes in contact with the mucosa for a more time. So if there is a stasis, there is a more exposure of the intestinal content to the mucosa and more chances of getting infected if the content contains AFB. Other reason is there is an abundant lymphoid tissue because of the Peyer's patches. The terminal ileum contains plenty of Peyer's patches. Then there is alkaline pH of the content, which favors proliferation of tubercular bacteria. Now let me tell you this, that the reasons why the stomach is not commonly involved are exactly the opposite. If you are asked why the stomach is not involved in tuberculosis, you will say rapid emptying of the stomach content, less than half an hour. There is a paucity of lymphoid tissue in the stomach and the acid pH of the stomach, which will kill the bacteria. Isolated jejunal involvement is very rare. However, the side-by-side involvement of the jejunum and the ileocecal region is very common. Ileocecal tuberculosis is commonly present with multiple jejunal strictures. The visceral tuberculosis, it can be hepatic, it can be splenic, it can be pancreatic. Splenic tuberculosis is very uncommon. And if you find a case of splenic tuberculosis, people report it as a case report. Now, what are the lymph node involvement? There can be isolated lymph node involvement in the abdomen. There can be lymph node can be involved secondary to the intestinal or the peritoneal tuberculosis. And the commonly involved lymph nodes are mesenteric, lymph nodes in the omentum, lymph nodes in the porta hepatis, ciliary group of lymph nodes, and peripancreatic group of lymph nodes. Ciliary group of lymph nodes and the lymph nodes in the root of the mesentery. The involvement of the lymph node in the root of the mesentery comes and sometimes give rise to caseation and the cold abscess. That is known as pseudomesenteric cyst. So the pseudomesenteric cyst is nothing but the caseation of the lymph nodes, tubercular lymph node at the root of the mesentery. Now, what are the different modes of presentation of abdominal tuberculosis? As I said, the presentation most of the time are non-specific. It can be generalized, non-specific presentation like low-grade fever, then it can be night sweats, it can be anorexia and weight loss, it can be malaise, fatigue, lethargy, lassitude, failure to thrive, particularly in the pediatric population. So these are the non-specific generalized features. There can be abdominal feature symptoms, specific abdominal symptoms like patient can present with abdominal pain. This abdominal pain can be colicky pain, which can be because of intestinal obstruction. This abdominal pain can be generalized pain. It can be because of the ascites. The patient can present with the abdominal distension, which can be because of the ascites or intestinal obstruction. Patient can present with a diarrhea, malabsorption because of the ulcerated lesion. Patient can present with a constipation because of intestinal obstruction. Then very important presentation in a chronic abdominal intestinal tuberculosis is gola formation. There is a moving ball of wind around the inside the abdomen. Then there can be audible bowel sounds. Patient can hear the bowel sounds and the gola formation. These are very particular in the Indian population. Then there can be a palpable abdominal lump in abdominal tuberculosis. Now there can be very important question: what are the causes of a palpable abdominal lump in abdominal tuberculosis? It can be right iliac fossa lump. It can be because of the hyperplastic ileocecal tuberculosis. It can be palpable lump in the center abdomen, which is because of the enlarged mesenteric lymph nodes. It can be lump in the ileoinguinal region because of the ileosauce abscess secondary to tuberculosis of the spine. It can be a lump in the upper abdomen, which is basically because of the rolled up abdomen. It can be a mass in the lower abdomen in females, which can be because of the TO ovarian mass. Or there can be lump anywhere in the abdomen because of colon tuberculosis, loculated ascites, or matted bowel loops. So these are the various causes of abdominal lump in abdominal tuberculosis. Now, what are the acute presentation of abdominal tuberculosis? Sometimes patient can present acutely in the surgical emergency. The most common acute presentation is intestinal obstruction, which can be because of the stricture. There are multiple stricture, but one of the stricture becomes so tight that patient goes into intestinal obstruction, which can be acute intestinal obstruction. It can be subacute intestinal obstruction. It can be because of the hyperplastic ileocecal tuberculosis, or it can be because of the acute presentation is, if there is a perforation of the ulcer of the tuberculosis, patient can present with perforation peritonitis. And this perforation is typically at a site which is proximal to the stricture. So if you see a perforation in tubercular abdomen, you have to see the stricture. There will be invariably stricture distal to the perforation in a tuberculosis. Then, although very rare, but sometimes because of ulcers, patient can present with massive GI bleed. Sometimes the patient can mimic ulcerative colitis because of the tubercular pancolitis. So it will be very difficult to differentiate between ulcerative colitis and tubercular pancolitis. Then sometimes the patient can present with acute abdominal pain, especially in pediatric age group, because of the TB mesenteric lymph adenitis. In the acute form, in the miliary tuberculosis, patient can present with a tubercular toxemia. There are sometimes unusual presentation, like esophagus is involved in less than 1% of cases. Esophageal involvement is very rare. However, if there is esophageal involvement, patient with can present with difficulty in swallowing, pain behind the sternum, or painful swallowing. Most of the time, esophageal tuberculosis occurs in the mid 1/3 of the esophagus, and there is an ulcerative lesion. And this ulcerative lesion, most of the time, it is secondary to mediastinal lymph nodes, which erodes into the esophagus. Primary involvement of the esophagus is extremely rare. And the diagnosis is most of the time by endoscopy and biopsy. Gastric tuberculosis. I have told you why the gastric tuberculosis is very uncommon. It can simulate or mimic peptic ulcer disease, or it can mimic the cancer. Or sometimes it can present as a gastric outlet obstruction. Other rare presentation of this gastrointestinal tuberculosis can be multiple chronic fistula in ano. If you see a case of fistula in ano, in which there are multiple opening or there are multiple fistula in ano with a protuberant granuloma around the opening and discoloration of the surrounding skin, you should suspect tubercular fistula and you take a biopsy. If sometimes the enlarged lymph node at the root of the mesentery can cause compression of the third and fourth part of the duodenum. Enlarged lymph node in the hepatoduodenal ligament can cause obstructive jaundice. Involvement of the peripancreatic lymph nodes can lead to pancreatic mass, and it can cause confusion in the cancer of the pancreas. But another rare presentation which we are coming for the last 10 years is that persistent sinus, discharging sinus after laparoscopy, in which there is a involvement of the laparoscopic side wound. Maybe because of the proper sterilization of the lack of proper sterilization of the laparoscopic instrument. Or there can be liver enlargement leading to hepatomegaly or spleen enlargement leading to splenomegaly. These are the typical ulcers. They tend to be annular. Solid organ I have described. Liver, spleen, pancreas can be involved, or it can be multiple miliary tuberculosis in which the liver, spleen and pancreas can involve. Now, how to investigate a suspected case of abdominal tuberculosis? If you do the blood test, you will find chronic anemia, albumin level will be raised, low albumin level, ESR will be raised. If you see a case of chronic abdominal problem and raised ESR, you should suspect abdominal tuberculosis in India. You can do the sputum for AFB, it may be positive. The sputum culture can be done by the BACTEC or LJ media culture. Ascitic fluid culture has a limited value, but estimation of SAG has a value. The most important diagnostic is adenosine deaminase test in the serum and ascitic fluid. ELISA test and PCR are emerging as a role, important diagnostic tool. Now I will like to discuss the role of PCR for abdominal tuberculosis. Now the PCR can be done by the single primer, that is IS6110. If you are doing the PCR for tuberculosis by the single primer, it has a very limited sensitivity of 47% and specificity of 95%. But if you are using the multiplex PCR, using the multiple probes and multiple primers, that is namely IS6110, 16 SR RNA and DEV RNA. So if you are using these three probes, so that is known as multiplex. As you go to the multiplex cinema hall with multiple screens, same way this is known as multiplex PCR. If you do the multiplex PCR using these primers or the two, then they have a sensitivity of 87% for intestinal tuberculosis and 76% for peritoneal tuberculosis. So if you have to do an abdominal PCR for tuberculosis, it has to be a multiple PCR with a multiple primers. But unfortunately, this multiplex PCR is not available routinely in across all labs. It is done only in the specialized lab. So this is very important slide that shows the sensitivity of various methods. If you talk of caseating granuloma on histopathology, they are seen in 21% of cases in intestinal tuberculosis, but they are not seen in peritoneal tuberculosis. If you talk of simple granuloma, they are seen in it around 30 to 82% of cases. AFB positivity is very low in abdominal tuberculosis, to the tune of 20% in intestinal tuberculosis and 2.9% in peritoneal tuberculosis. AFB culture may be around 40 to 50% in intestinal tuberculosis and 30% in peritoneal tuberculosis. TB-PCR, you can see from here that multiplex TB-PCR has a high sensitivity, around 87 to 75%. Gene expert test, only experimental, not much role. Ascitic fluid ADA, you can see 94% sensitivity. Then another test for peritoneal tuberculosis is laparoscopic visualization and histopathology. That is coming in a big way. So this table is very important to know. Then if you do the chest X-ray, you can see the active pulmonary lesion. Abdominal X-ray, if you do, you can see the dilated jejunum loop, ileum loop. Barium study we used to do previously, but now with the wide availability of the CT contrast study, we are not doing the bariums these days. But whenever when we used to do the barium study, we used to see the structure with proximal dilatation, thickened ileocecal valve, narrowed terminal ileum, fibrotic terminal ileum opening. All this is known as Sterling sign. All these signs can be seen in the CT contrast study. So the radiological investigation of choice is CT contrast study, CT abdominal, CT abdomen with contrast. And which contrast you will use? It will not be barium, it will be gastrography. Barium we are avoiding because when we were using barium, it used to precipitate intestinal obstruction. So these days we are using the contrast study, gastrography. So this is the classical napkin ring in the colonic tuberculosis, where my pointer is, this is the napkin ring sign. This is the colon, this is the ascending colon, this is the, so there is a narrowing. These are the tubercular strictures in a barium meal follow through. Same picture you will see in the CT contrast study. Another radiological investigation which can be useful is ultrasound, which can show the gross thickening of the bowel. It can show the adherent bowel loop. It can show the enlarged lymph nodes, mesenteric thickening, loculated ascites. That is also known as club sandwich sign. Then I have already told you can do the CT abdomen with a contrast gastrography study. Capsule endoscopy can be done, but the drawback of the capsule endoscopy is that you can't take a biopsy. But if you do the endoscopy, ileoscopy is a procedure in which you do a colonoscopy and then you push another scope through the colonoscope which goes into the ileum and you can take a biopsy. This is known as enteroscopy, terminal ileoscopy. Then laparoscopy is coming in a big way for diagnosis. Undiagnosed abdominal pain, you have ruled out everything. You are not able to find out any diagnosis. It is best to put a laparoscope, small incision, and have a look inside the tummy, and you can take your biopsies. Now, what are the surgeries in abdomen? What is the role of surgery in tuberculosis? Now, let me tell you that once you diagnose abdominal tuberculosis, surgery is only indicated in few conditions, which I will discuss. Otherwise, you have to start the anti-tubercular treatment. How much anti-tubercular treatment, that I will discuss in the next slide, but let us discuss the indications of surgery in abdominal tuberculosis. It may be indicated in whenever there is a doubt in the diagnosis. It may be indicated if there is a mechanical obstruction like acute intestinal obstruction. It may be indicated in a intestinal hemorrhage if you are not able to control by conservative measure, or it can be indicated in an acute abdomen. These are the various surgical procedures. Now, another important diagnosis, like when you go to the UK or USA, Europe, they don't see the abdominal tuberculosis. They see the Crohn's disease. In India, we don't see the Crohn's disease that often. So there are certain parameters which can differentiate abdominal tuberculosis from Crohn's disease. Whenever I used to work in UK in 2004, and then I didn't see even a single case of abdominal tuberculosis. There they used to diagnose all these cases like a Crohn's disease. So what are the findings in favor of Crohn's disease? It is based on the Bayesian model. Crohn's disease mainly occurs in the males, although the females are not immune. They commonly present with the bloody stools. They also commonly present with the perianal disease. Much more incidence of perianal disease in comparison to the abdominal tuberculosis. They have a high incidence of extra-intestinal manifestation. Ulcers in the Crohn's disease are linear. Ulcers in the tubercular disease are transverse. And there's a cobblestoning of the intermittent mucosa. There is a mucosal bridging and involvement of the rectum in Crohn's disease. However, it is classically absent in abdominal tuberculosis. So these are the few of the features which can differentiate Crohn's from the intestinal tuberculosis. But in the end, sometimes it may not be possible to give the diagnosis of Crohn's disease or abdominal tuberculosis even on biopsy. If you send the slide to two different pathologists, one pathologist may say diagnose Crohn's disease, other pathologist may say it is tuberculosis. So sometimes it is really difficult. Now, all of you know what are the tuberculosis chemotherapy. This is the slide which shows INH, rifampicin, ethambutol, pyrazinamide, and streptomycin. This is the adverse side effects of this. I will not go into details of these side effects and this doses. It's a standard thing. Now the question is, abdominal tuberculosis, whether the 6 month treatment or the 9 month treatment or the 8 month treatment. Because the WHO recommends the 6 month treatment, but many of the experts in India, or that I will say Asia, they recommend the 8 to 9 month treatment. Now, if you want to do the 6 month treatment, you have to start 4 drugs for the initial 2 months, followed by 2 drugs for the 4 months. If you believe that the 8 month treatment should be given, then you can start 3 drugs for the first 2 months and then the 2 drugs for the next 6 to 7 months. Now you may be wondering why I'm not mentioning DOTS. Now the DOTS is equally effective. I'm not in favor against the DOTS. DOTS is equally effective, but there is no study which can prove that efficacy of DOTS with the home care treatment. But what I will say, the decision should be left to the patient, whether the patient want to take a home care self-treatment by prescription, or the patient want to take a DOTS. But all the patient of tuberculosis, they should be registered as per the Government of India programs. That is more important. Any tuberculosis case you diagnose, whether it is abdominal tuberculosis or it is a pulmonary tuberculosis or tuberculosis any part of the body, before starting treatment, as a responsible clinician, we have to register that patient on the Government of India tuberculosis site. That is most important. And then it depends on the patient, whether patient to take a domiciliary observed, directly observed treatment, or patient to want to take a drugs from the store. However, the patient might need a prolonged treatment in case of immunosuppression like HIV. Now, sometimes, what is the role of steroids in abdominal tuberculosis? The role of steroid is controversial. It is not widely indicated. We are not routinely using steroid in tuberculosis of the abdomen. On the contrary, to tubercular meningitis or cold abscess in the lymph node of the neck, we do use steroid, but in abdominal tuberculosis, we are not using steroid. But sometimes maybe we may be forced to use steroid, like patient presenting with tubercular toxemia, patient presenting with adrenal crisis, or patient with ascitic type of peritoneal tuberculosis to prevent the adhesions. So these are the three possible indications of starting steroids along with ATT in abdominal tuberculosis. Otherwise, steroids are not indicated. This is the end of the lecture. Now we invite the questions.
Thank you, Dr. Jain. I would now request you to please open the Q&A tab and take up the questions from there.
Okay. There is a question from Jivitesh Parida. Is BCG vaccine useful in COVID-19? Answer is yes or no. Still, we don't know. There are so many papers which are coming that BCG vaccine may be useful. And there are so many studies which shows that why Indians don't have so much of mortality in COVID. It is because of that. All of us has BCG vaccine. So still we don't know the answer, but hopefully the BCG vaccine is saving us. Question is from Harshit Kumar Vashne. How the abdominal tuberculosis can mimic the other disease? The answer to this question is that, as I said, that tuberculosis is a great mimicker. It can mimic the cancer. Like suppose there is a patient who present with the abdominal lump and weight loss, anorexia, and patient in the 50 years of age. Obviously, you will like to rule out malignancy. So that way, it can, tuberculosis of the abdomen can mimic any disease. That's why I said that you have to keep all the possibility in your mind and rule out one by one. Another question, how to differentiate it with the atypical tuberculosis? It can only be differentiated by the culture. There is no way out. Another question, is there anything like appendiceal tuberculosis? Isolated tuberculosis of the appendix is not known, but involvement of the appendix in allosuccal tuberculosis is extremely common, but isolated appendicular tuberculosis is not known. Now another question is, can abdominal tuberculosis can also affect the greater omentum? Yes, it can affect the greater omentum. Another question, what do you see upon examination when there is a moving bowel of wind? You will see the moving bowel of gut loop around the abdomen. That is history of gola formation, which the patient can see, and sometimes you should be able to see that. Another question is, does the acidic environment of stomach can kill the FA? Why does ingestion of sputum is a cause for GI tuberculosis? The mycobacterium which escape the acid environment go there, because it's not a guarantee, because the half stomach emptying time is only 1.5 hours. So whatever bacteria which escape the stomach acid, will go into the ileum and they will cause tuberculosis. How to differentiate skin lesion and Crohn's and tuberculosis or ulcer in abdominal tuberculosis? I think answer is by biopsy. You have to take a biopsy by. Why is ADA level raised in abdominal tuberculosis? It is because of the increased secretion. Is tuberculosis a notifiable disease? Yes, it is a very well notifiable disease. All the diagnosed cases of tuberculosis has to be notified, booked on the website. If the physician fails to notify the tuberculosis, he can be prosecuted. Is there a role of any pure medical treatment for abdominal tuberculosis? Yes, majority of the abdominal tuberculosis, they will respond to medical treatment. Only few of the patient of abdominal tuberculosis will need a surgical management. Next question, how fallopian tube is responsible for the abdominal tuberculosis? Because the fallopian tube opens into the abdomen, there can be migration of bacteria inside the peritoneal cavity. How long is ATT in HIV patient? I don't know how, any particular study, but in my practice, I give for 1.5 years. But if you ask me any study, I have not come across any study, but in my college, in my department, I give for 1.5 years. How to differentiate peritoneal metastasis from peritoneal tuberculosis? That can be only be done conclusively by the diagnostic laparoscopy, because peritoneal mets cannot be diagnosed by any imaging method. If you have a suspicion of peritoneal metastasis, you have to do a diagnostic laparoscopy. Now, how to differentiate abdominal tuberculosis from miliary tuberculosis? That is on the basis of multiple involvement. If more than one organ is involved, like you said that abdominal tuberculosis, meningitis, or then it is miliary tuberculosis. For exam viva purpose, what is the best answer to give for cause of evening rise of temperature and night sweat? It is because of the low grade toxemia. Can you say now? Somebody asked, want me to share unique cases that I can share later on. Elsevier can give my email ID, I can share later on. How to differentiate from tuberculosis from sarcoidosis? Again, from biopsy. There is no other way out. Only biopsy, because even sarcoidosis can give you granuloma. But granuloma in the sarcoidosis are sometimes in the midline, but the final answer lies in the biopsy. Is the ascitic fluid present in the peritoneal tuberculosis? Yes, basically it is present in the ascitic peritoneal tuberculosis. Whenever there is intestinal tuberculosis, along with the involvement of peritoneum, ADA will be increased. Now, another question is, should we go for surgery in a case of HIV patient with low CD4 count who is present with acute intestinal obstruction and complication? Yes, there is no way out. You have to go for surgery. Acute intestinal obstruction, not responding to conservative management, you have to go for surgery. Complications, perforation, peritonitis, there is no way out. You have to go for a surgery. Only thing is, how much surgery do you have to do? You have to do the damage control surgery only. You don't have to do an extensive surgery in such a scenario. Because our main aim is to have a live problem, live patient. Will fever and night sweats occur, always occur in abdominal tuberculosis? Not, it may be absent in many of the cases of abdominal tuberculosis. It can be present in Hodgkin's lymphoma, so it is not a foolproof of abdominal tuberculosis. What can be the complications of atypical tuberculosis? Non-healing ulcer. Atypical tuberculosis commonly present with a non-healing laparoscopy wound. Can abdominal tuberculosis present as a periumbillary mass? Yes. how to differentiate between Crohn's disease and tuberculosis, I think we have already told. Moving bowel of wind, it is the moving loop of bowel which goes from one segment of abdomen to another segment of abdomen, which the patient can feel and patient can palpate, and sometimes the surgeon can also palpate. Can you please explain the moving bowel? Explain. It is, in the common language, it is known as gola formation. Gola pet mein banke ghumta hai. If you want to ask the patient, you can say that pet mein gola banke ghumta hai ki nahi. All the questions on the moving ball of wind, it has attracted the students. Can abdomen can become resistant to first line drugs? Yes, if the patient is HIV positive, or if the patient takes inadequate treatment or irregular treatment, any tuberculosis can become resistant. What is the treatment approach for ascitic tuberculosis present with obstruction? If the patient present with ascitic tuberculosis with subacute obstruction, I will like to treat conservatively with ATT. If the obstruction does not respond, then I will like to operate. And next question, when ultimately we have to reach the see the terminal ileum, suddenly we put the scope via the rectum, so we could differentiate the ulcerative colitis also. When ultimately we have to reach and see the terminal ileum, terminal ileum, if you do a good colonoscopy, you can see the terminal ileum. If a trained gastroenterologist is doing a colonoscopy, they say that your colonoscopy is not complete if you are not able to reach the terminal ileum. So, and beyond the terminal ileum, you can put a sister scope and go through this. What is the preferred treatment for extensively resistant tuberculosis? It will be based on the culture. Does Mantoux test have a role in the diagnosis of abdominal tuberculosis? Not very much. Mantoux test, all of those who have got a vaccination, or those majority of us, we have a latent tuberculosis. It may not have, but if it is strongly positive, more than 20 millimeter, then it may point out towards active tuberculosis. But it is not diagnosticable. What is the treatment of MDR tuberculosis? It is as per the drug culture. Why ADA decreases? It is because of the decreases in HIV, because of the decreased metabolic activity. A little clarity on the stasis with most exposure to mucosa. Very good question. Because you know that because of the patency of the ileocecal valve, intestinal content directly don't go into the colon. They remain there for 2 hours or 3 hours. Whenever the ileocecal valve relaxes, they go into the colon, or whenever there is a peristalsis. So with the patent ileocecal valve, there is more exposure of the intestinal content to the intestine. And if the intestinal content are infected with AFB, there are more chances of ileum getting infected. Does MD multi-drug tuberculosis infect kidney and pancreas? It can infect. Can intestinal tuberculosis can cause fecal fistula? Intestinal tuberculosis per se don't cause fecal fistula, very rare. However, if you operate upon a case of untreated abdominal intestinal tuberculosis, fecal fistula can occur. Can swine tuberculosis occur without history of pulmonary tuberculosis? Yes, it is a possibility. Why tuberculosis occurs in HIV patient? Because all of us are exposed to tuberculosis. We are exposed to latent tuberculosis. And whenever there is a decrease in the immunity, HIV patient are immunocompromised. So we get. So like in the present scenario, all the immunocompromised patient in the present scenario, they are advised to stay home. All diabetic patient, all patient. Same way, whenever there is an immunocompromised patient, there are more chances of infection. Ascites can be generalized or incested. How to diagnose obstruction in ascitic TB? Ascitic TB will not give risk of obstruction. Only the intestinal tuberculosis will give rise to obstruction. What is the recurrence rate after complete treatment? I don't have exact figure, so I can't tell. But if the patient has taken treatment completely, recurrence rate should be very low. Why granuloma is present only in intestinal tuberculosis? Because of they have got more time to grow there. Can Meek syndrome considered as a differential diagnosis? I don't think so. Meek syndrome can be considered as a differential diagnosis. Can abdominal tuberculosis patient can be asymptomatic? Yes, they can be asymptomatic and they can suddenly present with perforation, peritonitis, and intestinal. First investigation, tubercular abdomen. First investigation in any abdominal condition is ultrasound. Followed by guided by the ultrasound, you can do the further investigation. How to prevent tuberculosis in patient on prolonged immunosuppression treatment? It is the same way like we are preventing COVID, not to come in contact with the open cases of open tuberculosis. Then only you can prevent, or the patient should use a mask. So any patient who is immunosuppressive should avoid coming in contact with a open case of tuberculosis. If the patient is resistant to streptomycin, what is the first preferred line of treatment? The first preferred line of treatment is four drugs: INH, rifampicin, pyrenigenamide, and ethambutol. If the patient is resistant to ethambutol, you can use the streptomycin. If the patient is resistant to streptomycin, then you can use the PAS, para-aminosalicylic acid. Does the abdominal tuberculosis spread to port side after laparoscopic biopsy? Yes, it can. Why abdominal tuberculosis occur mainly in the, I have already answered that, ileocecal region. Is the stomach pH kills stomach? Yes, bacteria, acidic pH kills bacteria, but it is not necessary that it will kill all the bacteria. Can abdominal tuberculosis can lead to appendicitis? Not exactly. Will the lesser omentum will be affected in abdominal tuberculosis? Not very commonly, but yes, we have seen cases. Greater omentum is more commonly involved. How abdominal tuberculosis can cause obstruction? It is mainly because of the non-passable stricture. Abdominal tuberculosis will cause obstruction. After damage control, maximum time after which fagot need to be demoted and definite treatment. Once the patient is stabilized, now when I say damage control surgery, I don't really mean that you will leave the abdomen open. That is one of the way, but other way is that don't do the primary anastomosis. Bring the ileostomy, stoma, to put the patient on the ATT. Once the patient gains weight, then you can close the stoma. We come to the end of the questions. Hand over to Priyanka again.
Thank you, Dr. Jain, for the session today. And you're answering so many questions. I thank all the attendees for joining us again. Hope you had a great experience. The certificate of the participation, recording of this session, and the remaining answers to your questions will be shared to you within 10 to 12 working days.
There are 88 questions. I think it is very exciting.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I'm really thankful to the audience. They have listened to me and then I think
contributing to the discussion. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you once again.
Audience, should we close the session?
I think that would be best.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you, the Elsevier team. Thank you to all the audience. I really enjoyed.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.